science and humanities, which has been created well before the Nobel Prizes, I guess. I learned it was founded in the 15th century, so it's even older than my institution in France. I belong to Collège de France, which was created in 1530 by the King Francis I. And my research has been performed at École Normale Supérieure, which was founded in during the French Revolution at the end of the 18th century. So we belong to old institutions which have a long tradition in science, and I'm glad to talk here, to give my first lecture after the Nobel lecture. So I'll be talking to you about the experiments we are performing at École Normale, where we manipulate photons which are bouncing between mirrors. But I would like to make a presentation which will be at the same time historical. I'll try to tell you how we came to these experiments, and also to be a didactic lecture. At some point, I will shift from the historical point of view to the point of view which will give explain the reasons behind this experiment and what we hope to get from them. As you know, quantum physics has led to the description of a world in which matter and light have at the same time a particle and a wave aspect. Atoms, which are usually described as discrete entities, have also a matter wave nature to them, and light, which is usually described as an electromagnetic wave, is made of discrete particles, the photons. And this duality has led to the description of a strange world in which atoms as well as light fields can be in state superposition, can be at the same time in states which are described by as classically different. So this is very strange, and we will hear more about that in the talk. This description of the world at the quantum level has been, of course, has emerged from the work of the founding fathers of quantum theory about 90 years ago. And it has come from the fact that some properties of matter and radiation could not be explained classically. But at the time when this theory emerged in the 1920s, it was not possible to observe directly the strange behavior of matter at the quantum level. The founding fathers of the theory, you see here a picture of Bohr and Einstein, were discussing this strange feature by describing what they call thought experiments. They assumed that they would be able to control and manipulate single particles, and they were trying to find out what would be the consequences of that, and in this way they described this strange behavior and the duality between matter and waves. You see here, for instance, the drawing by Bohr of the famous photon box experiment. Einstein and Bohr came to the description of this experiment to discuss the Heisenberg uncertainty relations. I don't want to give you the details, but you see the basic idea was to trap a photon inside a box and to release this photon through this shutter. And an important element in this experiment was this clock, which was timing the experiment. And we will come back to this combination between boxes and clocks later on in the talk. But when they were discussing these experiments, they did not believe that they would one day become possible. And in particular, Schrödinger doubted very much that it would even be possible to manipulate single particle at this level. And these experiments were described in the 1920s. But as far as the 1950s, Schrödinger was very doubtful about the possibility to do these experiments. In fact, in the 1950s, it was clear that particles did exist. They were detected in bubble chambers, for instance. But what was going on in these experiments, that what one was detecting, in fact, the traces that the particle left in the bubble chamber, or in accelerator physics, your particle collide, and you look at the debris of these collisions. So this is, in some way, post-mortem physics. You look at particles which have disappeared, and you get just the remnants of these particles. And Schrödinger put it in a very nice way. He wrote in 1952, "It is fair to state that we are not experimenting with single particles any more than we can raise ichthyosauria in the zoo. We are scrutinizing records of events long after they have happened." So this was a state of the art up to the 1980s. And then new technologies have emerged which allow us now to really experiment with particles in the zoo, so to speak. That is, to have live particles with which you can work. And this has been possible because a lot of technologies have been developed which we need for the experiment. For instance, tunable lasers, which allow us to manipulate single atoms in a very delicate way. Fast computers, which make it possible to record the data as they occur at a very fast rate and to process the data, make correlation experiments and so on. And in some cases, superconducting physics, as you will see, we need very good mirrors, superconducting mirrors, to keep the photons long enough to be able to perform experiments. So all these technologies have evolved slowly, and now many labs in the world are manipulating single particles, controlling them, and even trying to use this strange quantum logic to do useful things. It's a branch of quantum optics called quantum information. And David Wynon and myself, we belong to this community of physicists, and it turns out that the Swedish Academy of Sciences has decided to put the focus on this physics, and we are lucky enough, Dave and myself, to become the representative of this very large field of modern physics. But I just wanted you to know that we will just describe to you a small part of this physics, and maybe we have been chosen because Dave and I have been working along these lines trying to manipulate the system for a very long time, and I will explain you a little bit the history as far as I am concerned. I just want to start by just making a parallel between Dave's experiments and mine. In fact, as it has been noted by the Nobel citation, our experiments are in fact the two sides of the same coin. We are manipulating non-destructively single atom with photons in Dave's case, and in my case, single photon with atoms. So you see here the picture which is used in the Nobel poster, charged atoms which are trapped by a configuration of electromagnetic fields, and laser beams are used to control and manipulate the atoms. And Dave will talk to you about these experiments later on in his talk. And we do the opposite. We trap photons in a box, and we use atoms going through the box one by one to extract information and to manipulate the photons in the box. And in both cases, we do it without destroying the system, so that I would call in vivo physics as opposed to the post-mortem physics that I was talking to you before. And just to show you how close these two kind of experiments are, I will also show you two figures, which have been taken from two papers that we published the same year in Physical Review Letters, back to back. It was in 1996, and I don't want to describe this experiment, but you can look at this as a signature of an atom which is coupled to an electromagnetic oscillating field in our cavities in Paris. And you see here a similar curve showing the signature of an atom oscillating in a trap in the Boulder experiment. And you see the two papers were published in the same issue of Physical Review in 1996. Technically, this kind of oscillation are called Rabi oscillations, but you don't need to know anything about that just to realize that these two kind of physics, these two signals are very close. The technology is very different, but we are doing similar things because basically what we are doing in both these experiments is to couple a two-level system to a harmonic oscillator. In David's case, the harmonic oscillator is a vibration of the particle in the trap. In our case, the harmonic oscillator is a single mode of the electromagnetic field in our cavities. But in fact, all this adventure has started much before 1996. And in my case, I can, if I want, just to give you the history, it has started with my thesis work with Claude Cohen-Tanucci in Paris. I did my thesis work at the end of the 1960s. And at that time, I was performing optical pumping experiments. Optical pumping is manipulating atoms, but big ensembles of atoms with light. And at that time, I was not using laser. It was light from lamps. But I learned that it was possible to manipulate the internal degrees of an atom in a very accurate way just by using the property of the light-matter interaction. And also I developed on that occasion the dressed atom formalism, which describes the interaction of light with matter by giving a description of light in terms of photons. In the case of the experiment I was doing then, it was not necessary because we used fields which contain a huge number of photons, so the classical description was all right. But the dressed atom formalism was very useful because it gave a very intuitive picture of the interaction, you know, the effects which were going on in terms of absorption and emission, real or virtual absorption and emission of photons. And this became more and more useful as we went into experiments in which we were dealing with less and less photons. And of course, the experiments we are doing now with single photons require this dressed atom approach because then really the quantum aspects of light becomes dominant. After I finished my PhD, I went to Stanford as a postdoc of Art Shallow, and then I learned to work with lasers. I used dye lasers, which were then being developed, pulse dye lasers, to excite quantum bits in atoms, to excite atoms by short pulses and look at the modulation of the light, fluorescent light emitted afterwards. These modulations were coming from describing the time evolution of state superpositions between sublevels in the excited state. So I started to, I became more and more aware of the importance of these state superpositions, which will play a very important role in all the experiments I will be describing to you. I just want to say that these two people have been have had a very great importance for me, and they, of course, both got the Nobel Prize, as you know. Claude in 1997 for atomic cooling, using lasers to cool atoms, and Art Shallow in 1981 for laser spectroscopy experiments. And I owe a lot to these people who have helped me to develop my love for quantum optics and for experimental physics. But the quest for going to single particle experiments started seriously when I came back to Paris after my postdoc, and I started to use at that time the dye lasers I have learned to use in Stanford to excite atoms to higher and higher excited states and to go into the states which are known as Rydberg states, states of atoms which correspond to very large orbitals. And I was at that time fascinated by the fact that these very large atoms were very sensitive to all kinds of perturbation, and in particular extremely sensitive to microwaves. So we started to perform microwave spectroscopy with these experiments in a setup which was very simple in its principle. You have an atomic beam, you use lasers to excite the atoms into very excited states, and then you irradiate the atoms with microwaves. And in order to define precisely the interaction region, we use the cavity, copper cavity made of two mirrors, to inject microwave and to excite the atoms. And after that, the atom drifted out of this zone, and they passed through between two condenser plates where they were ionized by an electric field. And this field was applied as a time-varying ramp of electric fields, and it reached at different times the threshold for ionizing the upper and the lower state of the transition, which was concerned with the microwave transition. And so we have a different signature for the upper state and for the lower state, and the change in the ionization curve was an evidence of the transition. And in fact, this time-resolved field ionization procedure is the one we are using up to now to detect very efficiently and selectively our Rydberg atoms. And we did the experiment, and in 1979, we observed a very strange effect at first. We realized that we did not need to apply any microwave. If we prepared the excited state of the atom, we got a fast transition from the excited to the lower state when the cavity was tuned on resonance. And we realized, in fact, that what we are observing is a Maser action. The excited system was spontaneously emitting radiation without having to apply any. And of course, Masers are well known, but what was very surprising here is that the threshold for this Maser was very low. For usual Maser or laser, you need billions of atoms in the medium, and here only a few thousand atoms were enough because of the high sensitivity of the Rydberg atoms. So in the paper, we made this remark here, that these experiments were opening the way to the study of even smaller systems going down to very small absolute numbers. And this was the beginning. At that time, we realized that by increasing the quality of our mirrors, we could get to the regime where a single atom would emit with exchanging a single photon with the cavity walls. And this was the beginning of our long adventure in this field. And I want also to say that it was the beginning of cavity quantum microdynamics, the field which studies the interaction of atoms with photons in a confined space bounded by mirrors. It is called cavity QED, cavity quantum electrodynamics, and it has known, it has developed very fast. And at the end, I will talk to you about other domains of physics where cavity QED is important. So we had to increase the Q of our cavity, and for that we went to superconducting mirrors. We use a superconducting cavity made of niobium, and we were able in 1983 to reach the regime where we got single clicks in our detector, meaning that the atoms were going through the cavity one by one, and we had a fast transfer of the upper to the lower state spontaneously produced when the cavity was on resonance. And this was, we recognized that it was a limiting case of a maser when there is only one atom in the active medium. So this is what we wanted, the regime that we wanted to reach. In fact, it had been predicted by Ed Purcell, the man who invented the magnetic resonance back in the 1940s. So it's called the enhancement of spontaneous emission of a single atom in a cavity is called the Purcell effect. But still, we are not quite satisfied because the Q of our cavity was not good enough for the photon to stay in the cavity. The photon was emitted very fast and then it was absorbed in the cavity walls. And what we wanted to reach is a regime where the photon stays in the cavity long enough to be reabsorbed by the atom and to get into a regime of reversible exchange of one photon with one atom. This is known as a strong coupling regime of cavity QED, and it became our holy grail. We wanted to increase the cavity Q to get to this regime. So it was a very exciting time in our lab, and I just show you a few pictures. Here I am in 1977 with my first graduate students, Michel Gross and Claude Fabre. And here you see a very important guy at that time, Philippe Goua, who was a wizard of microwave technology, and we developed the microwave sources and the microwave analyzers that we are still using up to now. In fact, he developed a small company to sell this microwave equipment to other people. So he played a very important role for us at that time. And here, this last picture showed me, and in front of me here, Jean-Michel Raymond, who was my graduate student at that time, and who had stayed in my group since then. And I will say a few words about this collaboration at the end of the talk. But still, we were struggling to improve our cavity Q at that time. And the problem was niobium is fine as a superconductor, but it's a very poor material to be machined with precision. And our cavity walls had some irregularity, some roughness, and the photon escaped by scattering, and we were not able to improve the cavity Q. And at that time, one day in 1984, we got news from Munich that one of our competitors, Herbert Walter, had reached the strong coupling regime in his experiment, realizing what has been known as a micromaser. So, you know, he was working with his graduate student, Dieter Meschede, and what they did was to replace the open cavity by a closed cylindrical cavity in niobium. And the fact that the cavity is closed is very clever to reach a high Q, because then even if there are some irregularities inside, the mode is slightly distorted, but the photons cannot escape, and they reach very high Qs. And they got into the strong coupling regime. And the micromaser is a system in which the atoms, the Rydberg atoms, cross one by one the cavity. They get out, they are ionized. And by analyzing the clicks here, they were able to show that the field was built up in the cavity by the emission of atoms one by one. And it's called a micromaser because it's a system in which the maser medium is made of no more than one atom at a time. And this micromaser has been given rise to a lot of theoretical and experimental studies in the 1980s and 1990s. Herbert Walter unfortunately died in 2006, but I wanted to acknowledge that he played a very important role in the early development of microwave cavity QED with a micromaser. Dieter Meschede became a postdoc of one of my postdocs during the years I was working part-time at Yale University, so we developed a strong friendship. He went then back to Germany in Bonn, where he started a very active group in working with cold atoms and in quantum information, and we have been exchanging students and postdocs over the years in a very fruitful collaboration. So we were worried by the fact that we did not have a good cavity enough, and we thought that we should shift to this kind of cavity. We did some experiments with closed cavity, but still we wanted to go on with open cavity because this kind of cavity has a problem. It has a very long lifetime, which is good for this micro-maser action, but the Rydberg atoms have to get very close to metallic surfaces here to get in and out, and the stray fields that you cannot control here were destroying the state superposition. So if you wanted to prepare atomic state superposition and have experiments in which the state superposition play a very important role, it was impossible to do it with our Rydberg atoms. And so it was much better to stay with large cavities, open structure cavities, but then you had to solve the problem of the surface irregularities. So it took us, in fact, 20 years to be able to get... I don't know what's going on here. It says that it cannot save, but I don't ask them to save anything. Okay. So it took us 20 years to get open structure cavities which have a Q as large as this one. And so now I will stop the historical approach and go and tell you what we are doing now. It will be easier to explain the physics in this way. But I want to start by one very important point. What about photon detection? Usually when you detect photons, you use a photoelectric effect. You have a photocathode, or your retina is also transforming the photon into some kind of nervous signal, electric current. And in the process, the photon is destroyed. So you see what happens is that you have single clicks in a detector, and each click, in fact, signals the death of a photon. You had a photon, the click means that you are back into vacuum. So the click projects the field into vacuum, and the photon dies. And it is what happens usually, the photons are destroyed. And in this process is equivalent, it looks very much like this very brute force process I described in the beginning. What you are looking at are the debris of the collision of a photon with a photocathode. And this is, of course, not what you want. If you want to make in vivo physics, you want to detect the photons in a different way. And so we were really puzzled by that. If you look at textbooks of quantum physics, a measurement does not destroy the eigenstate that you measure. In fact, what we wanted to achieve is a situation where the click, we have one photon, the click means that you still have one photon after, and so you could detect the photon again and again. And this is called a quantum non-demolition measurement, which is a standard measurement that you find in all textbooks of quantum physics. So we were puzzled by the fact that quantum optics was, in fact, measuring photons in a way which is not the textbook way. And the quantum non-demolition way, in fact, was pioneered. The theory of this quantum non-demolition experiments was pioneered by Vladimir Barginsky back in the 1970s. But for that, to achieve this quantum non-demolition detection, you need a detector which does not absorb the photons, but which is very sensitive, which can take an imprint of the photon at the single photon level, a nonlinear process which leaves on the atom an imprint at the single photon level. And you also need a very good box to keep the photon alive long enough. And so this is the photon box we have come to. And for that, we had to improve the cavity mirrors. So it took us a very long time. For 20 years, we improved steadily the Q of our cavity. In the 1990s, we had a Q factor which corresponded to lifetime of the photon in the 100 microsecond range, which was good enough for some experiments, but not good enough for the QND experiments. And then we came with the final idea, which was to combine the mechanical properties of copper, which is very easily machined, with the electrical property of niobium. So we took copper mirrors, machined them with very high precision, and sputtered a thin layer of niobium on top. This is a technology used for cavities in accelerator physics, and so we collaborated with people in the CEA in Paris to achieve these mirrors. And eventually, in 2006, we obtained very good mirrors. You see here a picture of these mirrors. They are not in the final position, but this gives you an idea. And these mirrors, in fact, we boast that they are the best mirror in the world. The light can bounce more than 1 billion times on them. You know, if you look at this structure, two mirrors facing each other is what you find in a lot of elevators. But if you look at the images in the elevator walls, you see maybe 20 or 30 reflections. Here you have more than 1 billion reflections. You are between the mirrors and you have the population of China that you can see on both sides. So it gives you an idea of the quality of these mirrors. And light is bouncing between the mirrors. If you unfold the trajectories, you get this Earth circumference, 40,000 kilometers, more than 1/10 of a second. And then you just have to send atoms one by one. And this is the way the experiment is done. The photons bounce and the atoms go one by one and extract information. So these are, but of course you need special atoms. And the atoms we are using are a special kind of Rydberg atoms called the circular Rydberg atoms. So here I learned in Sweden that Rydberg is a very interesting name, and we had at one of our dinners with the Rydberg beef, which I think has nothing to do with Rydberg atoms, but I also at the Nobel lecture I gave last week, the grandson of Rydberg came to the lecture, so it was a very interesting encounter. So what are circular Rydberg atoms? We start with an atom in its ground state, which has a dimension of about 1 angstrom, and then we promote with lasers and radio frequency excitation into a circular orbit, which has a dimension which is about 1/10 of a micron in diameter. So it's a very big antenna. The preparation of this circular Rydberg states was pioneered by Dan Kleppner at MIT in 1983. And I want also to acknowledge the importance of Dan Kleppner for this physics, not only because he studied the physics of Rydberg states, which was very important for us, but also because he made very important contributions to early cavity QED experiments. For instance, he observed in his lab, using circular Rydberg atoms, the inhibition of spontaneous emission between two closely spaced mirrors. So how can you describe such a circular Rydberg atom? What you have, in fact, is you have to remember electrons are also waves, so you have an electron wave going around, and the wavelength is a de Broglie wavelength, and the quantization condition that you must have an integral number of these de Broglie wavelengths on the circle, and this is the number of de Broglie waves is the principal quantum number, basically. So you see that when you prepare a circular Rydberg atom, the electron wave is completely delocalized. You have a uniform density, which means that you have no electric dipole. And if you want to couple to light, you need to build an electric dipole. In order to build an electric dipole, what you do is that you apply a pulse of classical microwave, which admixes two Rydberg states, adjacent Rydberg states, with principal quantum number 50 and 51. So you prepare a state superposition. And such state superposition means that the atom is at the same time in state E and G. And so if you want, you can call it a Schrödinger kitten. It's a very small Schrödinger cat because it has only one particle in it. And by interference, what happens is that the two waves interfere constructively at one end of the orbit and destructively at the other end. So you get now a wave packet which rotates at 51 gigahertz, which is the transient frequency. And this wave packet is like the hand of a clock rotating very fast. So in fact, what we are doing when we prepare this system is that we build a Rydberg clock, an atomic clock using Rydberg atoms. And this Rydberg clock will be exceedingly sensitive to light. And the reason it is sensitive to light comes from an effect which brings me back to Claude Cohen-Tanucci, who discovered in 1961 that if an atom is non-resonantly interacting with a light beam, the energy levels are slightly shifted. It's called a light shift effect. And we are exploiting this light shift effect. First of all, the Rydberg atom has to be slightly detuned from the cavity because we don't want the photons to be absorbed. And so we'll use light shift effect, which is a much more gentle way to interact than just to absorb or emit photons. And you see what happens when the atom in level E enters in the cavity, the energy levels are pulled in one direction, in level G in the opposite direction. And you have this, if you prepare a state superposition, a phase accumulation, which depends upon the photon number. And you have a phase shift of this atomic dipole per photon, which you call phi naught, which can be as large as pi because of the extreme sensitivity. And this means that after the atom has crossed the cavity, the dipole will point in one direction if there is zero photon, and in the opposite direction if there is one photon. And if you are able to measure this phase shift, you will be able to discriminate between zero and one photon. But to measure phase shift, you have to build an interferometer. And the interferometer we built is shown here. You have your cavity, which stores a photon, the box which prepares circular Rydberg states, the atom drift, and you detect the atoms here. And the very important parts of the experiment are these two auxiliary cavity, R1 and R2, which are two in which you apply microwave pulse before the atom enters the cavity. So you prepare a state superposition here, it evolves, and then with a second flash of microwave, you analyze the superposition downstream. This succession of two microwave pulses realize what is known as a Ramsey interferometer, the separated oscillatory field method. And these interferometers have been invented by Norman Ramsey at the end of the 1940s, and they are the standard instrument used in all modern atomic clocks. The cesium clock works according to this process. So really what we are building here is an atomic clock sensitive to light. And I just want to stress that Norman Ramsey was the PhD advisor of Dave Wineland, so you see that our stories are entangled in many ways. We are basing our research on things which have been done earlier by our mentors. So you see that in the simplest way, what happens is that the second pulse is taking the atomic superposition which points in one direction and maps it into level E, and the opposite direction into level G. So if you have a pi phase shift per photon, detecting the atom in state E or G, getting a bit in the state 1 or 0, if you wish, will be directly correlated to the photon number inside the cavity. And we see that on this trace, which represents an experimental trace. A red bar is an atom in level E, a blue bar an atom in level G. Time goes on here, it's a real it's a time scale of the order of 2 seconds, and you see these kind of traces. And there is some noise, but you see immediately that when the photon number changes, the cavity is at a very low temperature, 0.8 Kelvin, and so according to the Planck's law, you have either zero or one photon in the cavity, and the number of photons fluctuates from zero to one randomly. And you see when the photon number changes, you see when the quantum jump does occur. This sudden change of state of the field, which occurs spontaneously, is called a quantum jump. It was predicted by the quantum theory, but it took a very long time to observe it. And the quotation I gave you from Schrödinger in 1952, where he doubts that one will ever see this kind of effects, had a very interesting title. It was called Are They Quantum Jumps? And I think Schrödinger did not believe that the quantum jumps could be observed. They were observed first in single ion physics by Dave Wineland and other groups in Europe, in the United States. He will talk about that later. But this is the first time these jumps were observed on a field and not on an atomic system. You can go now to larger photon numbers. So, and you also see that hundreds of atoms see the same photon over and over again, which means that it's really quantum non-destructive. You can also detect larger photon numbers. For this, of course, a single atom is not enough, but if you make a phase shift per photon smaller, and if you send many atoms, each atom will provide some partial information, and you can use this information to reconstruct the photon number probability distribution. We start with a field, for instance, here, which has a very small photon number, but you don't know whether you have 0, 1, 2, up to 7. And since you don't know anything, you have to assume that the a priori knowledge you have is a flat histogram. And you will see how this photon number changes as a function of time when you keep sending atoms across the cavity. And it's a real experimental signal. So you will see what's going on. You see here that the photon numbers between 5 and 7 between 4 and 5, excuse me, and eventually the photon number 5 wins this race. So in this experiment, we start with this photon a superposition of different photon numbers, and the measurement forces the system towards a given number, which is what always happens in a quantum measurement. You start with a system which is in a state superposition, and you end up with a given photon number. It's called the collapse of the wave function. And so you see here that you see directly how the photon number of this field collapses. And if you keep measuring on a longer time scale, what you see are the quantum jumps of the field which goes down to vacuum. And you see that at the quantum level, a field does not decay exponentially. It decays by staircase evolution. And you recover the exponential decay if you make an average of a large number of similar experiments. What you see here is the passive observation of the field. But you can very recently, we did another kind of experiment keeping the field into a given photon number. And it's called a quantum feedback experiment. That is, we measure, and from the information that we get, we add or subtract photons to force the system to stay at a given photon number level. And you see the result here. You can force the system to stay with 4 photons, and here with 7 photons. And we recently performed these quantum feedback experiments, which are important if you want to use these non-classical states to do useful tasks for quantum information, for instance. But I think I spoke enough about this photon aspect, the particle aspect of light. Here, the experiment I described to you up to now focus on the particle nature of light. But as I said at the beginning, there is a dual aspect. Light has also a wave aspect. And this duality is interesting. You see this, this is called an ambigram, and give you a feeling of what the wave-particle dualism is about. Depending upon the kind of information, the perspective of your experimental setup, you can read here, light is a wave or light is a particle. So you have to put yourself in the right frame of mind. And as an experimentalist, you have to design your experiment in the right way if you want to see the light or the wave nature, the particle or wave nature. So let's go to the wave aspect. And this will lead us to the discussion of Schrödinger cat experiments. But I will give you a very brief account because I see that the time is passing by quickly. And for that, I remind you the tale of Schrödinger's cat. You put in a box a large system. So he took a cat. It could have taken any microscopic system with a single atom. If the atom is excited, nothing happens. If the atom goes to the ground state, it emits a particle which triggers a contraption which kills a cat. And of course, if your particle is halfway between having decayed or not, the particle is in a state superposition, and so the cat should be in a state superposition of being alive or dead. So you see that the cat story has to do with entanglement. This kind of wave function is non-separable, it's an entangled state, and you have to entangle the large object with a small object. And in our case, our version is that the small object will be an atom with 2 levels, but the large object will be a coherent state of the radiation field made of many photons, a few photons. And we prepare this state of few photons in 2 different states corresponding to 2 different phases. So I just have to remind you that a classical field, a field which has a well-defined amplitude and phase, is like a C number. It's a complex number with amplitude and phase, describes the phase and the amplitude of the field. But quantum mechanically, the end of this arrow is a little bit fuzzy because you have uncertainties in amplitude and number. So you have to represent this as a distribution, a Gaussian distribution in the complex plane. This is the best description, the most classical description you can give of a field made of a few photons. And these fields are called coherent states, and they are produced quite naturally by feeding the cavity with a classical current source. So you get this kind of state. And this distribution is called a Wigner function. It's a 2D representation of your field, and it gives you all the information you can have on the field. This is a classical field. If you now have this classical field interact with a single atom, you can transform this Wigner function into a non-classical Wigner function. For instance, when we measure with atoms and perform a QND measurement, we transform this state into a Fock state, a state which has a well-defined photon number, and its Wigner function has a quite different shape. But I don't have time to discuss the Fock states, I will just discuss the Schrödinger cat state. In fact, in the paper that we wrote in 1992, we realized that the setup which was performing quantum non-demolition measurements of photons, the Ramsey interferometer, could, with a single atom, produce a Schrödinger cat. And the paper was written with this fellows Luis Davidovich and Nissim Zaguri, who are Brazilian theorists, who helped us very much to develop these experiments. And so when a single atom crosses the cavity, you get from a coherent state, you build up the Schrödinger cat state. So the two, you could consider that this is a live cat, and on the other end, you have the dead cat. And in between, you have fringes of the Wigner function, which describes the coherent superposition, the fact that you can make quantum interference experiments with the system. And this has to be contrasted with a classical mixture, which will give the two Wigner components, the two coherent components, without the coherence. So how do you prepare the cat? It's very simple. You need a single atom. You start by preparing a coherent state in your cavity. You send one atom. In R1, you prepare a state superposition. And each part of the superposition will phase shift the field in the cavity in one direction or in the other. In fact, this single atom crossing the cavity is a kind of small piece of dielectric material which has a different index when the atom is in E or in G. In state E, it pushes the field in one direction. In state G, it pushes the phase of the field in the other direction. And here you have an entanglement. This is a Schrödinger cat. And then the atom goes through the second Ramsey zone. And the effect of the second Ramsey zone is very important because it will erase the tracks. You will not be able to tell here whether the atom was in state E or in state G when it crosses the cavity. And this leaves the ambiguity of the cat. And when you detect finally the atom, you prepare, you project the field into a cat state superposition, superposition of this phase and that one. You can also look at this experiment as an experiment in which you use the field as a meter to measure the state, the energy of the atom. This meter is going in one direction if the atom is in state E, in the opposite direction if the atom is in state G. And in all quantum measurement, you always entangle the system that you are measuring with the apparatus, which is the meter. And you get Schrödinger cat state, but of course they disappear very quickly due to decoherence, and I will come back to this in just a while. So we did that experiment, and in fact, what you have, of course, to measure the Wigner function of the cat. So you prepare the cat with the first atom, and then you use a sequence of atoms crossing the cavity one by one to measure the Wigner superposition by a modified version of our Q&D experiment. And in the end, you get experimentally this kind of Wigner function, which show you the live cat and the dead cat state and the quantum interference in between. And we did many experiments of this kind. And then what you can observe is how the quantum coherence disappears. These states are very fragile. And due to the coupling with the environment, due to the loss of photons in the mirror walls, very quickly, this quantum coherence will vanish. And if you take snapshots of these cats at increasing time, you see the decoherence to occur. And this will be shown here. I just want to stress that the theoreticians who describe this problem and showed how the decoherence is connected to the coupling with the environment and who inspired us to do the experiment is Wojciech Zurek from Los Alamos. And I just show you here the movie which we have made, which shows how the fringes that you can see in a few 20 milliseconds are washed out, and you end up with a statistical mixture of the two components. So this kind of experiment shows you the decoherence process in action, how a quantum state becomes classical, and this is an exploration of the boundary between the quantum and the classical state. The rate at which this occurs becomes faster and faster when you increase the size of the system. And if you look at a cat which has billions of molecules in it, you understand that you will never see the coherent superposition. You will always see the end result, which is a classical mixture. In fact, we had done a similar experiment a little bit earlier in the 1990s, and this is the first experiment which shows how decoherence increases when you increase the size of the system, it goes faster and faster. So I think at this point, I will conclude by telling you that similar experiments are now performed with other systems. This is the Rydberg atom microwave system, but you have also experiments performed in the optical domain, making much smaller cavities at optical frequencies and coupling them to cold atoms. And one of the pioneers in this field was Jeff Kimball from Caltech, and another one is Gerd Rampe from Munich. You can also couple atoms or quantum dots to the evanescent field of microstructure resonators in whispering gallery modes of microtorus of microspheres, and beautiful experiments are performed with this system. You can also embed quantum dots, which are artificial atoms, between layers of Bragg layers and you, or photonic band gap materials. And last but not least, a field is now developing very strongly. It's called circuit QED. It replaces the atoms by an artificial structure, a superconducting circuit with a Josephson junction coupled to a coplanar line with a standing wave of radio frequency. And this system is quite the same as the one we have here. And a lot of experiments are now being made in many groups in the world, performing circuit QED experiments, which look very much like the cavity QED experiments that I am doing here. So I think I came to the end of what I wanted to tell you, but I just want to show you that if you have not followed quite all what I said, you can find on the internet a movie which was posted on the day the Nobel Prize was announced, which explains in less than 3 minutes how you can control a single photon without destroying it in a cavity. So I like this movie very much, and if you have these 2.5 minutes, I will show it to you now. It needs some sound because there is an explanation given, and so I hope the sound will work. In order for us to see something, it either needs to be a bit like, can you hear? So I want you to see up to the end, because this is an advertisement for this website, and they have other movies of this kind on Schrödinger cats, on Planck's law, which are very interesting. And I think the guy who is doing this movie has a lot of, he's an expert in this field. So I will close here by making a few comments. I want to acknowledge, first of all, I want to say that it's a collective effort, and I have been working for a very long time with my colleagues. Jean-Michel Raymond was my student 30 years ago, and Michel Boyne was a student of Jean-Michel Raymond, and we have been working on this project for at least 20 years. And of course, we are not working alone, the three of us. We have had a lot of students, visitors, and postdocs, and this is the last generation which gathered on, last October. And I want also to emphasize the importance in this experiment of two young people, Igor Dotsenko and Sébastien Glaise, who are we performed some of the last experiments I described to you. I also want to say that this would not have been possible without the support of the École Normale labs and the atmosphere, the spirit of the École Normale physics, which allow you to develop freely a long-term project without being asked to deliver a result at a very fast pace, and this was very important. This spirit was created by the founders of the lab, Kastler and Brossel. Kastler, who got the prize in 1966, and I just finished by showing you a picture which was made in the very same room that you see here, but 46 years ago. On the day that the Nobel Prize of Kastler was announced, you see here Claude Cohen-Tanucci, and this is me. And I will stop at this point. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a beautiful lecture. I think we have time for a couple of questions. Are there some brave students that want to ask?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I would like to know about the Schrödinger
Yes.
So do you think the cat is both dead and alive, or is it dead in one world and alive in another world?
No, it is both. You know, when you see these interference features in the middle, what it means is that you can take the two parts of the cat and recombine them to give rise to interference effect. So as long as you see the fringes in the Wigner function, it means that the system has a potential to show quantum interferences. So this means that it has to be at the same time dead and alive. As in the Young double slit experiment, if you see fringes, it means that a single particle is going through both slits at once. Of course, in the end, after the decoherence has occurred, when you don't see the fringes anymore in between, it means that then the cat is either dead or alive, just you don't know which it is until you make the measurement. So I think that's what it means. But of course, this works because you have a very small system in the box. If you take a real cat, the cat has to be surrounded by many things like molecules of air for him to breathe and thermal photons, because you would freeze it to death if you put it at 0 degrees. So in fact, the cat is surrounded by a lot of things around, and it has no meaning to describe the wave function of the cat. The cat is entangled with the environment, and the only thing you can describe for the cat is a density matrix in which all the quantum currents have been killed already. So that's why this experiment becomes ridiculous if you want to extend it to the macroscopic world. But the dream of quantum information is to be able to make small cats with, let's say, few tens, few hundreds, few thousands of atoms, and control them in a way that you could use the quantum logic and the quantum interferences to perform interesting tasks.
Okay. Any other question? Maybe I can ask a question. I find this experimental measurements of the coherence very interesting. Yeah. And you discussed a bit about the time scale there.
Yes.
If we would think about an experiment at a subatomic level, maybe with nuclei or yes. elementary particles, what do you think would be, how would the typical time scales change?
I don't know. I think there is no general rule to, there is no general expression for the decoherence time. For each system, it depends how it is coupled to the environment, how you describe the environment, and what makes this experiment quite demonstrative is that in this case, the nature of the environment is not so much important. You can describe the environment either as modes of the field outside the cavity or as atoms which absorb sometimes a photon inside the cavity walls, and you find the same result. What Zurak showed is that the decoherence time is inversely proportional to the number of photons you have in the system. And this is quite easy to understand. As soon as you lose one photon, this photon is a kind of spy which you could use to measure the phase of the field which remains in the cavity. And the fact that you can use this photon as a spy will destroy immediately the quantum coherence inside. Now, the time it takes to lose a single photon becomes, of course, shorter and shorter if the number of photons increases. And this is a classical effect. If you have a pond with many fishes, the time it will take for you to fish the first fish will decrease. If you have more and more fishes in the pond, it will take shorter and shorter time to extract the first fish, unless you are very clever fishermen. But it happens sometimes, but usually it works that way. And so you see that the decoherence time, of course, can be understood in quite classical terms.
Okay. A question up there, please.
Yes. For the time being, of these experiments, there are no applications. You know, this is just theoretical demonstration of the fact that you can manipulate single particles or a few particles, because our system is very cumbersome. We have Rydberg atoms, which are difficult to prepare, which fly across our cavity and so on. But you see that there are already other people working. For example, circuit QED is replacing our atom with small elementary pieces of circuits that you can prepare by lithographic techniques on a board, and you can now make these kind of experiments in with superconducting physics at a scale which is completely different. So this is the kind of thing that we hope. We make some demonstration with a very cumbersome system, and then other clever people come, use the same ideas with other technologies, and then if in their technologies they can have tens of such artificial atoms coupled together, they will start to build small versions of quantum computers. And Dave, in his talk, will describe experiments in which he used ions in traps. And again, he's now working with a few ions, but if the traps evolve and if thousands of ions could be controlled in the traps, then more and more elaborate versions of quantum computers could be built. The issue is whether we will be able to beat decoherence or to control decoherence. And for the time being, nobody knows how it could be achieved. But I think this is always the way fundamental research works. It gives seeds for application to emerge later. And this has been the case in the past. When the laser was invented, nobody knew that it would be so useful 50 years later. And you can multiply the number of examples of this kind of situation.
I think in view of the time, we have to stop here and thank Serge Haroche. Thank you again.